sun off today. While we're waiting for Governor Clinton to arrive, we have some important introductions. George Bush has been trying to speak for Michigan auto workers lately, but we have... originally from Bay City, Michigan, UAW Local 362, now Director of Region 1D of the United Automobile Workers of America, and he can really speak for Michigan auto workers. Jack Laskowski.
Those in the shadows, the sick and the disabled. Let's just look back at the last 12 years and think back on what Hubert Humphrey said and what has happened. You know, one in four children go to bed every night hungry. We got 40 million Americans today without any kind of health care. And when you look at, when you think about that, they estimate that some 27 million of them are working. And he sits there, when you think about the registered voters that did not go to the polls and the ones that did go to the polls, 19% of the electorate of this state elected the governor that we had sitting in Lansing today. And we have another candidate out there that's, you know, he says, I'm all ears. You know. But let's not make the same mistake and get led down that primrose path like we did 2 years ago in that governor's race. You know, only one time in the history of this country, and the last time it happened when the Electoral College did not elect the president was in 1824, when there were four candidates running for, drew the popular vote in this country, and a guy by the name of John Quincy Adams came in second. And in all their wisdom, when it went to the House picked the second candidate. It's vitally important this time that, it, and that would be Bill Clinton. Thank you.
Well, they comprise our country and our state, and especially this district. And we can be so proud that for 18 years, Bob Traxler represented us in Congress. When I was down in Washington recently, I found out just what a legend Bob was as I talked to various members of the Congress in both parties. And those are some huge shoes, as I say, to fill. And all I can say is I'll do my very best, if with your help I win on November 3rd, to make sure that we get this country moving again, that we have someone in that office who's going to be responsive, and also someone who will strongly support Governor Clinton in his efforts as he attempts to turn this country around and get our economy moving again and create the opportunity for so many of our people to pursue the American dream. Thank you very much. It's great to be here. Thank you for giving Governor Clinton a warm, warm welcome that he deserves.
Now, I know you would like me to be able to tell you that the governor is here, but I can't do that yet. So what we're going to do is turn the music back on for a little while. oh, you want some more space? And we'll come back here and socialize, have some cider, and we'll come back and let you know as soon as he's out of the way. What do you want? You don't like, we could have some music again for a little while.
I wrap my fear around the lifeline.
inspiring speaker, Reverend Roosevelt Austin, Zion Baptist Church. Welcome.
So ladies and gentlemen, it's extremely important. The mayor and other speakers before me indicated your right to vote is a fundamental principle that we can't just take for granted. It's important to Mid-Michigan, it's important to this state that you get out and vote. It's important that we make that change. We need someone with intestinal fortitude that'll take this state and this nation, jumpstart the economy, and really start putting people back to work. The problem in this country is that this recession is real. It's been real. In Michigan, we're in a silent depression. I'll tell you how real it really is. We're gonna lose more manufacturing-based jobs to the southern states and probably out of this country. We need the leadership that understands the working men and women of this state and this nation. If we can only do that, we can change in the White House. Not the State House, the White House. And that'll happen with your help. And obviously, you came here to see Governor Clinton, the next president of the United States. And I want you to know that you'll be here any minute, but you have to put up at least one more or two more speakers. A good congressman from the 7th and 8th congressional district will be up. We can't stand four more years. It's time for a change, and we need to do it now. Thank you.
Gentlemen, how sweet it is. You know, you strength. stretch back and you go far enough, they hear you all the way to Washington, D.C. You're America speaking, and this is your election, and you're going to take back your government. It belongs to you, and for 12 years, 12 long years, it's been under the stewardship of individuals and a party. But 4 years from now, you know what we're going to be doing. It's going to be re-elect Bill Clinton. The reasons that America is supporting him and want him and are committed to change. It's because they want improvements in our environment, they want improvements in our economy, they want improvements in education. They're concerned about the future of their children. They're worried about the direction this nation has taken. And they're saying, we don't want more of the same. And Bill Clinton and Al Gore represent change. They represent a return of the government to the people, to you. It belongs to you. This is your nation, your country, your future. The reason we're all here today is to welcome the next president of the United States, Bill
Saginaw, I'm glad to be back. love these signs. I like the pumpkin in the back. It ought to be Halloween for Bush and Quayle. We need to spook them out of the White House. I want to thank all the people who are here. Senator Levin, Senator Riegel, Governor Blanchard. I want to thank especially Congressman Traxler for that emotional, wonderful speech, a testament to the kind of America we ought to have and to the service he's given you in many years in Congress. I know you appreciate it. He was part of a bizarre scheme to get Iran deeper and deeper into this scandal. Today we learned that Secretary of State Baker pushed for giving more money to Saddam Hussein even after he was warned that Saddam Hussein's government was involved in criminal activities. And look at this. Can you believe it? In Washington, they've got the FBI and the Justice Department investigating each other. They don't have time for criminals anymore. They're looking at each other. They've got, in Washington, the Bush administration has got the CIA and the Justice Department fighting over which one of them lied to the federal court over this Iraq scandal. And we now know that three political cronies in the State Department actually spent their time not only looking into my passport files, but investigating my mother. Now, the only thing about it was they had these three political hacks that sneaked into the passport file rooms between 6 o'clock and 10 o'clock at night. The only good thing I can say about it is that the only time those political hacks worked till 10 o'clock at night, the whole time George Bush was president. And now it turns out today, Mr. Perot is accusing Mr. Bush of investigating his children. So now we've got this bizarre situation where Bush and Perot have accused each other of investigating each other's children. I'm going to tell you something, folks. I want to investigate your children, their problems, their promise, and their future. That's what this election is about. How in the world these people can be talking about this when the state of Michigan's lost 125,000 manufacturing jobs since Bush has been president, when this country's lost 1.4 million manufacturing jobs, when most Americans are working harder for lower wages than they were making 10 years ago, including most of the people in this audience today, how can they be talking about each other? They ought to be talking about you and your future. That's what I'm committed to, putting this country back to work. I think this country needs a job creator, not a job destroyer, as president. I got into this race for president because I was sick and tired of seeing our people work harder for less. Because I saw people in my state work over and over and over again, working their fingers to the bones and falling further behind. I got into this race because I didn't want all the children in this audience, including my 12-year-old daughter, and all the children of America grow up to do the first generation of Americans to do worse than their parents. I think we're better than that, and I think we can do better than that. Do you know, my fellow Americans, that in Japan, 28% of the workforce works in manufacturing. In Germany, 32% of the workforce works in manufacturing. But in the United States, only 16% of the workforce works in manufacturing, going down every day because the people you put in charge and follow trickle-down economics, they're rewarded big money. I want to reward the hardworking people of America, rebuild the manufacturing base, and rebuild the American economy. To make up your mind in this election whether you want somebody who is seriously committed to rebuilding the job base of this country or not. In the 1980s, when manufacturing jobs declined by 6% in America, by more than that in Michigan, they increased in my state by 11%. This year, no matter how much Mr. Bush tries to convince you to the contrary, his own government says Arkansas leads the nation in private sector job growth. More new jobs in Arkansas than the entire country since George Bush has been president. That's what we need for America. We ought to be sick of these people telling us that this election is something about anything other than your future and your family and the values you live by and whether you're going to be rewarded. I'm telling you, folks, I am sick and tired of this. I have worked for a dozen years to help people keep their jobs, to create new jobs, to maintain good manufacturing jobs. And what has this administration done? They gave a $300 million trade break to Japan by letting in their multi-purpose vehicles and lowering the tariff on them. And did we get anything for it in return? No, nothing. We just gave it to them. We gave it to them while the trade deficit with Japan was going up and the jobs were going down. It is wrong. I want more trade. I want expanded trade. But if somebody wants something from the United States under my administration, they're going to have to do something for the United States so we both grow together. This administration has done. They have spent your tax dollars, your hard-earned tax dollars, to provide low-interest loans to factories if they would shut down and move to Central America when those same factories couldn't get the loans to modernize their equipment here. I say more incentives for new plants, new equipment, and new small business in America, and stop subsidizing moving our jobs overseas. Let's subsidize building our jobs at home. Administration advertised with your tax dollars that American factories should go to Central America where people work for 57 cents an hour. And they didn't even help the people in Central America. They gave the money to people who lowered their wages so that after they'd done this for a year, they cost jobs in America, thousands of them, and driven wages down in Central America. I say we ought to have a trade and investment policy that builds the American economy and helps wages to go up here and in Central America instead of driving them down with trickle-down economics, treating working people like they were dirt. When you strip away all the rhetoric and all the bull and all the charges, when it all comes down to it, the question is, are you going to have a president who is committed to rebuilding opportunity for the American people who are willing to work hard and play by the rules, willing to educate themselves and change, willing to build a new future? Look, I have worked for a dozen years at this. A lot of people can say, well, vote for me, I'll do better next time. That's what Mr. Bush says. He says, I'll focus on America if you give me one more break. Thanks a lot. You know, a lot of people can claim, well, they are outsiders. Let me tell you the facts. Of all the people you could vote for president this time, of all your choices, only one of them has ever balanced a government budget. Only one of them, only one of them has never been part of the Washington lobbying scene. Only one of them has ever done anything to restrain the influence of lobbyists and special interests on the political process. Only one of them has ever passed a program to help people through a legislature to create jobs and improve education, and that's the same one that made the good vice presidential choice of Al Gore. Bill Clinton, you need to help me get along. Exciting and challenging time. Too many Americans have been hurt by the changes of this time because we have no plans to take advantage of the changes. When things are changing, change will be your friend or your enemy, and you have to decide which it will be. Change has not been our friend because we've not committed ourselves to education of our children and our adults as we should. Change has not been our friend because we've cut the defense budget without reinvesting every last dollar in rebuilding the American economy. That's what I want to do. Take that money and spend it not on higher health care costs, not on the SNL bailout, but spend it on roads and transportation systems and rail systems and water systems and environmental cleanup systems, putting the American people back to work by cleaning up the environment and building the economy. We need new ideas for America, and we don't need a bigger government, but we need a government that works. Let me tell you, this again is inconvenient for the Republicans who are attacking us, but my state has the second lowest tax burden in the country, but we have increased investment in jobs and education in the environment, and is trying to move our country forward. I think that's what we want for America. And I'll tell you this, we need some new ideas that impose more personal responsibility on people. In our state, we are doing something we ought to do around the country. Take first-time nonviolent offenders, particularly those who've had drug problems, and instead of sending them to prison where they can learn how to be first-class criminals, or putting them back on the street when they think there are no consequences, put them in community boot camps and let them do work and education and training and get them connected to society. Change the welfare system as we know it. Make it a second chance, not a way of life. Invest in people. A real chance. Invest in people who are on welfare. Invest in their education and training and support for their children, and then require them to go to work. And if there are no jobs, create those jobs. We ought to have the toughest possible system of child support in this country. You ought not to be able to cross the state line. Yeah. Never put the power of the federal government beside the child support enforcement system like we should. Give me a chance and I'll do it. The little children of this country deserve to know that their parents are taking care of them. That's not something the government can do, nor something the government should do if people can do it for themselves. These are the kinds of things that we ought to do. And let me give you one last new idea, one that embodies the themes that I've been hammering for a year now. People who get opportunities should assume responsibility. We should become a stronger community by doing things for each other. That's my plan to open the doors of college education to all Americans. And here's how it would work. I want to take the best of the American GI Bill and the American Peace Corps to come out with a national trust fund to rebuild America. You can borrow the money to go to college and pay it back as a small percentage of your income after you go to work at tax time, so you can't beat the bill. Or in the alternative, and better, the people of this country can pay their college loans back by working for a couple of years as teachers, as police officers, working with the elderly, working with people with disabilities to help them maintain their independence, working with our children to keep them out of trouble, working in housing programs to help solve the homeless problems. You think of it, we could solve the problems of America and generate a whole new thrust of Americans with education second to none in the world. We need new ideas. We do need an outsider who can make government work. But more than anything else, we need somebody who wakes up every day not investigating his opponents, but investigating you, your problems and your promise and your future. I believe in this country. I believe in its promise. If it weren't for the American dream, I wouldn't be here today. I believe in what I have seen in the faces of Americans all over this country on these bus trips. I believe in the stories that I have been told by Americans who want to do better. This morning when I left Grand Rapids, a woman came out to the airport with her children to see me. And she started crying. She said, "I am a single mother. I am raising my 5 children. I am working as hard as I can. I want to be part of your American family because I want the American dream to live for my kids." That's the kind of person I'm fighting for in this campaign. And let me tell you, we only have to put up with this if you're willing to fight for change for 9 more days. You think about it. Look at what they're doing in their campaign. Every day, Mr. Bush goes out and just creates another fairy tale. He pulls out his pocketbook, his wallet, and says, "You better watch your pocketbook if you vote for Clinton." Now, remember, folks, remember, Bush increased spending by more than any president in over 2 decades.
Bush asked Congress to spend more money than it did. He tried to outspend Congress. Can you believe that? Bush increased regulation by more than any government president in two decades. My state has the second lowest tax burden and the highest job growth rate in America, and I'm the only person to ever balance a government budget. I'll tell you who's going to pick your pocket. George Bush, he did it once, and if you give him another chance, he'll do it again. But you know, we're not buying it this time. To all of you, you know as well as I do, we did not get into this mess overnight, and we'll not get out of it overnight. You know that there is no perfect person who could be president, but you have given me a chance to come here to Michigan and to Saginaw to make my case. I haven't seen him here today, but I want to thank Dennis Fitting and Local 455 of the UAW for letting me come here in the springtime to make my case there. I do not promise to be a perfect president. If you elect me, I'll make some mistakes, because unlike the guy that's there now, I'll do something from day one. I'll get up every day going to work and try to get something done. But I'll tell you this, we will make progress. And I'll wake up every day in that White House with the idea that it is not my house, it's your house. And I am nothing more than a temporary tenant and your chief hired hand. And that if it hadn't been for you, I wouldn't be there. And the only purpose of the presidency is to use the power of the presidency to help people. They have used the power of the presidency. They have used the power of the presidency to help their special interest friends long enough. They have abused the power of the presidency for their own political purposes. It's time you had somebody who really believed in change and really fought for it, who really believed in you and your future, who really believed that we ought to exalt hope over fear. Now, for 9 days, you're going to see a battle for the spirit of America, an intense battle in which people talk about change, but you ought to know there's a difference between talk and action. I've given you action. People will talk about you and your interests, but remember where they were when your interests were being savaged in the last 4 years. People will raise fears. The Bush campaign is nothing but a collection of the same old fears that this tired old Republican Party has raised now. They've been in too long. They've forgotten about their power of government to help people. They've used it to help themselves and help their political cronies, and we've had it long enough. They've run out of ideas and energy and direction, and we need to run them out of Washington on November the 3rd. I'm going to ask you one last time. Will you help me change the future of America? Restore hope to the American dream? Will you help me bring the American people together across the lines of race and region and income? Do you believe we can do better? On November 3rd, make it so. Let's change America and lift Americans. Thank you. Send this man to Congress, will you? Thank you. I want to come out and shake hands. I really appreciate you being here. Thank you very much.
be when I'm with you. I wanna stay there. If I'm true, I'll never leave, and if I do, I know the way there. And I suddenly see you. Ooh, did I tell you I need you every single day of my life? I get you out of my life. Kind of high.